Father, we thank you for the opportunity to come to hear your word. Lord, we don't come to hear from a man. We come to hear from you. Tonight, we ask as we look into your word, Lord, as we hear your heart for us, your church. God, I pray that your Holy Spirit would speak to us right where we're at, minister to us and to our hearts to confirm things, to solidify things, to open us up to vulnerabilities that we may not know, Lord, that we might grow in your kingdom and grow in your ways. Lord, we invite your presence of your Holy Spirit to be our teacher, to be our counselor today, that we might be equipped and fulfilled to be who you've called us to be, your church. And Lord, we give you the praise and the honor. We give you the glory for all that you'd accomplish in this house and the houses all across the Inland Empire that are hearing the gospel and preaching the gospel of Jesus. We ask that you'd bless them as well. And Lord, we thank you for that in Jesus' name. We all together said,
amen.
Amen. If you've got your Bibles, I'm going to go to a couple of verses today. So I'll just have you turn there. If you've got a ribbon or a thumb, you can just stick it in there and leave it there. But you can go to 1 Kings in the 5th chapter. You can go to Jeremiah in the 32nd chapter. We're going to go to those two verses today. I'm going to just share with you some things about what's been taking place in my life, and I believe that God's imparted some things into my life that I know it's very difficult to communicate and to convey some things that I've experienced when you haven't experienced it, but today I just thought I'd share what God has put on my heart because I believe that it's too big to just leave it to me. A couple of days ago, I returned from a trip, my second trip in 3 months to Israel. I had this amazing, literally God-ordained experience of invitation in which I went to Israel for the very first time with Lori. I see Lori and a couple other people, Bob and Marilyn on the front row. We got to spend some time in Israel a couple of months ago, for the very first time for most of us. And God did some amazing things into my heart. And I met a man that was out there very connected with the Messianic congregations of Israel. And a couple of weeks after I returned, he called me back and said, "Hey, I want to take you to Israel again." And I was like, "Okay, you know, a trip to Israel, who's going to say no?" And he said, and to make it even better, he says, "I'm going to take you on my dime." And it was like, "A free trip to Israel? Let me pray about it. Yes." So I got to go, and the trip was put together by a group of believers based out of Los Angeles and around the United States, a group of believers called the Israel Christian Nexus. It was chaired by Dr. Jack Hayford, and it's an organization that is in place to begin to build relationship with Christian and the Jews of Israel to develop this relationship together. And so this trip that I was just on was with 30 millennial pastors. You would probably have never seen so many skinny ripped jeans in your life in Israel. Long t-shirts, skinny jeans, undercut haircuts. We all looked the same. We all talked the same. We all laughed at the same stupid jokes together. It was probably overwhelming for anybody who was over 36 years old. They were like, "I just don't understand." But it was a group of 30 millennial-aged pastors. And the idea or the precept is that young people are not connecting with the nation of Israel in which the older generations were. As a matter of fact, it was really kind of a funny story. The first time I went to Israel, the youngest member of our group, a friend of mine, Brad Andrews, I don't see him here tonight, but Brad got stopped at the airport coming into Israel on the premise that he was the youngest person in a group of primarily retirement age people, and it was very suspicious for a 21-year-old to be traveling with a bunch of 50 and 40 and 60-year-olds. And so they said, "It's suspicious. Are you sure that you know these people? Because it's just not something that happens very often." And so they brought 30 millennial pastors to connect them with the people of Israel, with the leaders of Israel. And so we got to see some amazing things. For the past 10 days, or for 10 days I spent in Israel, I got to connect with some great governmental leaders. We got to go places that are kind of off limits on your regular tour. It was truly a trip of a lifetime. Beyond just going to a trip, beyond just getting a free trip to Israel, it was really a connection for the younger generation. Because when you look at the subject of Israel, it's amazing how this little tiny sovereign state in the middle of the Middle East can cause so much tension around the world. Geographically speaking, the country of Israel, if you want to know what Israel looks like, you can turn to the very back of your Bible, and there's generally a map in the back of your Bible, and you can look at what Israel is. Israel is slightly smaller than the state of New Jersey, but yet so much tension, so much news, so many issues stem from this small state the size of New Jersey. Because there's something about it that's very special and very unique. And there's something that the world needs to understand and recognize. And particularly us, you and I, the people of America and what I would call the Western church, that we need to realize and recognize with God. We got to go on some amazing things, and what was really unique about this trip is that it's so rare for young pastors, not just young people, but young pastors to make the pilgrimage to the Holy Land, that it started piquing the interests of a lot of people. We spent some time and we filmed a television show for God TV on the campus of TBN Jerusalem, right there in the old city of Jerusalem. We filmed a TV show. CBN came out and filmed us because they said, what the heck are 30 millennial pastors all doing in Israel? And so they came out and filmed a special on them. As a matter of fact, an Orthodox Jewish rabbi from Beverly Hills flew to Israel to spend 3 days traveling with a bunch of knucklehead 30-year-old pastors who think they know everything about everything, just to see what's going on, because this kind of thing never happens in Israel. And it was a really unique experience. It was a real eye-opening experience. And truly in my own heart, I have to say that there are just some, you know, they say some things, they say sometimes that there are things in life that are just caught and you can't, that are not taught. I caught the bug. I got bit. I was telling my mom, it was my second time in Israel, and I told my mom after leaving, after 10 days, I told her, I said, Mom, I felt like I left home. I felt like I went and visited my home for 10 days, and I came back to the mission field in which God had sent me to San Bernardino. Because there's something so unique about this nation. It's not just a nation that causes political turmoil. It's not a nation that's in the news right now with the United Nations vote and the very first time that the United States abstained from a vote on behalf of Israel. It's not anything about that. There's something deeper. There's something greater. And it was so interesting to spend time with Orthodox Jews, and we got to spend some time, and we went to places like yeshivas, a school for Jewish scholars, and got to converse with Jewish scholars and to understand and to look at our Hebraic roots of where Christianity came from. And some things opened up to me that I had never realized and I had never recognized before. You see, I teach church history here at the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. And church history tells us that after the fall of the temple in 70 AD, the Roman general Titus destroyed the temple that Jesus went to. We read the stories of Jesus overturning the tables of the money changers at the temple. And when he would go up, like every good devout Jewish follower would do, to go to the temple to make their pilgrimages on the holy days, that very same temple in 70 AD, about 30 years after Jesus died, maybe 40 years after Jesus died, that temple was destroyed. And church history tells us that around that time, the Christians and the Jews began to go on separate paths. That the Jews stayed Jewish while the Christians became predominantly the word Gentile or non-Jewish. And that's what church history tells us. And then eventually it became Catholic. And then about 500 years ago, in October this year, we'll celebrate 500 years, this thing called the Reformation happened. And we kind of branched away from Catholicism and we printed the Bible in the English language. And now all of a sudden you and I, we're the byproduct of this great journey of Christianity. But one thing that church history doesn't tell us is that through the course of millennium, some of the greatest persecutors of the Jewish people were Christians. In the name of Jesus. You see, things like the Crusades, you know, when you think of Orlando Bloom and the Kingdom of Heaven and these people that were taking the great holy city of Jerusalem back from the Muslims. And you can say, you know, these amazing feats and the crosses and the Knights of Templar and all Indiana Jones and the Holy Grail and all the different things that we see from the folklore of the Crusades. The things that we don't see is that the Crusaders, as they pilgrimage their way to Jerusalem from Europe, they killed the Muslims on their way, but they also slaughtered Jews and burned their synagogues as well. That in 1099, when the Second Crusades took over Jerusalem, that every Jew in Jerusalem was killed just alongside with every Muslim. And throughout the course of history, there were many other areas and many other aspects of Christian persecutions. I was never taught, I'd never realized, I'd never recognized that the Nazis were singing Silent Night on Christmas Eve as they were walking Jewish people into the gas chambers of Auschwitz and Birkenau in Germany. And they had crosses on their necks as the symbol of the backing of their solution to the Jewish people. And so you can see and you can understand that there's some things like that, that to the Jewish people of Israel, to the people that have made the pilgrimage to make Israel their home, the Christians, you and I, were not necessarily viewed as the friendliest people to them. Many of them were telling their stories today. In our day and age, growing up in places like New York and New Jersey, of being persecuted, by other kids at other schools saying, you're the ones that killed our Jesus. You're the ones that killed our Jesus. And so there's this fear of Christians. Some of them even still call us today crusaders as we come to Jerusalem. And yet, as I began to go on this pilgrimage, on this journey that God was taking us, young leaders, to connect with this great land, this holy land, God's promised land, I began to see something, and my eyes were open to something that was unprecedented in history. And that is the realization on the Jewish side, on the Christian side, and on the Catholic side, that we share some very deep commonality together. And that somehow, in some way, God has intermingled us and intertwined us, and that our fates are not separated, that we should not have gone our own separate ways and our own separate journeys, but rather God has intermingled and intertwined us. And for the very first time in history, in this generation, our eyes were open to the revival of the understanding that we are, as Christians, recognizing that the Jews and Israel is an important thing, not just a country that we see in the news media, but something important to our faith. And the Jews begin to realize and recognize that the Christians are important to their future as well. And now all of a sudden, an allegiance, an ally, our hearts begin to reach out to each other. Eyes were open, even though we don't have the same theological agreements, that there is more that binds us together, that separates us together. And for the first time in 2,000 years of history, Christians and Jews and Catholics are joining together to build and to restore God's nation, to fulfill God's prophecy, to usher in the return of the Messiah, Jesus Christ, to the earth again. And now all of a sudden, a revival globally is breaking out throughout the course of this world. China is becoming one of the largest backers of Israel, the underground church of China, because they're recognizing and realizing that Jews did not go one way and Christians another way, and that the Jews of today are not the people that killed our Jesus, but rather they are the root from the tree in which you and I have been grafted into God's kingdom, and they are important to God's end time plans. And our eyes were open and our minds were blown. I mean, we visited some crazy places. You want to hear about some of the crazy places that I visited? I visited a neo-ecumenical Catholic seminary. What is that? Here's a picture. It's a beautiful hall where there's students, where the students would come. This is a spirit-filled Catholic seminary built on the Mount of Beatitudes, Matthew the 5th chapter, in which they teach every student that comes to read biblical Hebrew, and they encourage every member of their congregation to learn, to read, and to study the Word of God. Now, if you know anything about Catholicism, that's unheard of. And so here, all throughout this seminary, were Hebrew writings, Hebrew inscriptions, and Hebrew thoughts as they gathered together to realize and to recognize that our Savior, Jesus Christ, was born, was raised, and died a Jew. And there's a root on the inside of us and in us that we cannot deny, that we cannot escape, that we cannot run from, and that yet they've realized, they begin to partner with. And here the Pope himself came to consecrate and to dedicate this Catholic movement back to Hebraic understanding, to learn the Bible, to teach the Bible in its Hebrew roots, and to teach their congregants to read God's Word. I got to visit a Catholic synagogue. You're like, I don't know. I don't even know what that means. A synagogue is a Jewish house of worship. But understand the paradox there is in that. I got to visit a Catholic, Christian, Jewish house of worship in which they gather together and on one floor they preach about Jesus and they recite the liturgy of their Catholicism, and on the floor underneath the Jewish brothers gather together and they praise and they sing the scriptures of the Torah together, and faiths are intermingling and joining together, recognizing that the God of the Jews, that the God of the Christians, that the God of the Catholics is the same God written in the same Bible. We just are seeing things from different lights. On top of this spiritual awakening, we got to see as millennials a governmental and governmental awakening. This is a picture of the Knesset. Now go back. Sorry, guys. Go back. This is a picture of the Knesset. The Knesset is like the House of Congress. We got to tour the Capitol building of Israel in Jerusalem, and we got to meet with dignitaries and what we would call congressmen or ministers or parliamentary members of Israel. And not just to, here's the crazy thing, not just to talk to them, but for them to ask us questions about what can Israel do to reach the next generation of Christians so that they would come and they would back this great nation. And it was a dialogue between us and them, brainstorming and thinking about the future of Christian-Jewish relationships. As a matter of fact, what was really cool is we got to visit the Minister of Interior Defense, the guy right there in the middle. There's a guy with the yarmulke. That was the Jewish rabbi that came all the way from Beverly Hills to travel with us. The guy in the middle right next to him, that's the Jewish Minister of Interior Defense. They say he will likely be the next prime minister of Israel when Benjamin Netanyahu retires. And we got to talk to him about how can Christians and Jews partner together to build Israel, to fulfill God's promise and prophecy. And yours truly got to talk about Chick-fil-A. You say, what was Chick-fil-A? See, after about 7 days of hanging out with two Jewish rabbis and an Orthodox Jewish guide, we began to realize that when you ask a Jew a question, they'll respond with a story. And so he asked us a question about how can evangelicals support Israel? And I said, sir, let me tell you a story about a restaurant named Chick-fil-A, in which the CEO simply said about marriage, I believe what the Bible says about it. And the world called for boycotting and mayors kicked them out of their cities. But yet, and everybody tried to ruin this organization. But yet, when the boycott was announced and my wife and I went to go to support this Christian-backed company, there was a line wrapped around the building two times over. Because when you can awaken the evangelical Christians to a cause, there is no stopping them. And he said, what is this Chick-fil-A? It's not kosher, so they can't eat it. But we got to tell that. So we got to meet with leaders and with dignitaries all across Israel. And our eyes were open to the fact that Israel is a miracle from God. You see, this little tiny state, this little tiny country the size of New Jersey, causes so much news, causes so much drama, causes so many issues around the world. But yet, there's something deeper for you and I as the church that we need to understand and that we need to see. You see, the very fact that Israel exists today is a miracle of God. It was so neat. We got to spend some time in the Independence Hall, kind of like what we would do in the place where we signed our Declaration of Independence in Philadelphia. We got to spend some time in Independence Hall where they signed the Declaration of Independence. Did you know that the day in 1948 that the British backed out of Israel and gave possession to the people of Israel, the very next day, five Arabic countries on all sides of them attacked them the very next day? There was no army set up. There was no minister set up. There was nothing set up but a bunch of Jewish people who wanted to return to their homeland and who had a dream. And they should not, by all accounts, have survived. But yet, you know what's amazing? Is they survived that onslaught of five Arabic countries, Lebanon, Syria, Jordan, Egypt, and Iraq, attacked them the very first day of their independence. You think about it like that. On July 4th, we declared independence in the United States. Imagine July 5th. Canada, Mexico, England, China coming against America to try to wipe us off the face of the earth. And yet, somehow, without an army, with no bullets, with no guns, with only the power of God, they survived and became a sovereign nation. And you know what was cool? Is our tour guide, who was leading us in the Independence Hall of Israel, he said this, and I love it. He said, Jews in Israel, we don't just believe in miracles. Like Mariah Carey, do you believe in miracles, right? Or Whitney Houston. He said, we rely on them. We don't just believe in them. We rely on them. Because in 1948, five Arabic countries wiped them out, tried to wipe them out, and yet they survived. In 1967, yet again, it happened. Egypt and all the surrounding countries once again tried to wipe them out. Then again in 1973, on the holiest day in which the army was on vacation for the Day of Atonement, Yom Kippur, they tried again, and yet somehow, miraculously, with one tank against 100 Syrian tanks, they held out. How? Because they don't just believe in miracles, they rely on miracles. Because Israel itself is a miracle. But you see, the great miracle is the very fact that here we are on the other side of the world. I was trying to explain to my 5-year-old son that it was nighttime when I was on the phone with him, but the sun was coming up where I was at. And I said, how can you explain that, Bjorn? Are you going to bed right now? Yeah. And I turned the phone over with FaceTime and it said, look at the sun's coming up. How can you explain that? Here's the miracle that on the other side of the world, we're talking about this little tiny state, the size of New Jersey, that survives and that is operated and by the sovereignty of God, that is a miracle that it even exists today. Why? Because Israel is the plan of God. Israel is the plan of God. The Jews who occupy, the Israeli Arabs that occupy Israel, because it's not just Jews in Israel, it's a sovereign state, is the plan of God. And the Jews are a miracle, and God has a plan for them. And sometimes, somehow, we get this opinion or we've gotten this view that it's our time and it's our season, but we need to understand that God has a great and a divine plan for His people, the root of the tree in which you and I are now a part of His people, and that God is doing something great. God is doing something unprecedented. God is doing something that we have never seen before on earth. It is happening right now before our eyes. How cool is that? You know what's really neat? What really, I think, begins to bake our noodles, if we can recognize and realize that, is when we look at Jesus a couple of weeks ago when Mom was talking about Christmas, she talked about all the fulfillments of prophecy that Jesus fulfilled. And the statistics are outrageous. There's no way to deny them statistically based on what we read. But you know what's cool is those are prophecies that were fulfilled. Sometimes it's hard to relate to something that was fulfilled 2,000 years ago. But you know what's really cool is right now, today, with your very eyes, you are watching and you are seeing, unbeknownst to you, the prophecies of God being fulfilled before your very eyes. God's word is truth. God's word is alive. God's word is relevant. And you and I are blessed enough to watch His prophecies come to pass right here, right now, in our lifetime. I had you turn to Jeremiah, the 32nd chapter. Jeremiah chapter 32, the prophecies of God. Let me show you a really cool prophecy. Jeremiah 32. I'm going to only put up a couple of verses. You can read all the way from verse number 26 through the end of 32 if you'd like. But I'm gonna just read you a couple of verses. Verse number 37. This is being fulfilled today as we speak. Behold, I will gather them. Who? The Jews. The Jewish people, the covenant people of God. Behold, I will gather them out of all countries. Do you know that there are Jews every day immigrating from the four corners of the earth, from Europe, from Africa, from America, from China, and from the East, coming from all four areas, from the north, from the south, from the east, and the west, coming to make their pilgrimage to move back to the promised land in which God has promised them. He says, I will Gather them out from all countries to where I have driven them in my anger and in my fury and with great wrath. I will bring them back to this place. What place? Israel. This was written in the nation of Israel. He says, I will gather them back to this place and I will cause them to dwell safely, and they shall be my people, and I will be their God, and I will give them one heart, and I will give them one way, and they may fear me forever for the good of them and their children after them. The fulfillment of God's words today. You see, every person that comes to Israel is taught Hebrew. Did you know that Hebrew, like Latin, was a dead language? Dead language, but yet they revived it. Why? To draw themselves closer to the words of God. God is fulfilling His prophecy with the people of Israel. You want to see something really cool? I didn't have this up on the overheads, but I want to read you something, and I want to show you a picture. Jeremiah in the next chapter, 33, verse number 10. Check this out. Thus says the Lord, again, there shall be heard in this place, of which you say, it is desolate and without man, without beast. In the cities of Judah, in the streets of Jerusalem that are desolate, without men and without inhabitant, without beast. Verse number 11, the voice of joy and the voice of gladness, the voice of the bridegroom and the voice of the bride, the voice of those who say, praise the Lord God of hosts, for the Lord is good and His mercy endures forever. Check this out. You want to see a prophecy of a miracle being fulfilled before your very eyes? Let me show you a picture from 1909. This is the city of Tel Aviv. If you've ever seen Don't Mess with the Zohan, the opening scene is Tel Aviv, the beaches of the Mediterranean. This is 100 years ago, 120 Jewish families casting lots for properties in sand dunes. Desolate place. No water, no buildings, no inhabitants, no tribes, no occupants. Sand dunes. Let me show you what Tel Aviv looks like from last week. That's Tel Aviv. As a panorama, it's kind of pixelated. I must have sent them a low image. That's 100 years later from that picture of sand dunes. That's taken from the same place that sand dune was taken on. Think about it. In 100 years, you're not talking about a third world country with developing plumbing. You're not talking about, you know, people of deep and in great poverty. You're not talking about people who don't have a healthcare system. You're talking about, in the matter of 100 years, a people who have a per capita of populace, understand this, per capita of populace more than double Nobel Prize winners of any country on earth in 100 years. They have health systems and health care for every person in Israel. We're trying to figure that out in America. They've already got it figured out. They've got public transportation. They've got welfare systems. They've got governmental systems. They have all sorts of different things. And every one of those high-rise buildings and the other side of the city looks exactly like that, did not exist just 100 years ago. Jeremiah 32. Jeremiah 33. That I will call them from all the corners of the earth in which I had sent them in my wrath, and I will bring them back to a place, and I will be their God, and they will be my people. You see, Israel is a miracle. The very fact that we are watching and witnessing this today is a miracle, which is important for us, you and I, to understand. Why? Because just 70 years ago, 6 million Jews were exterminated on the continent of Europe. You see, the devil's going to do everything he can to eradicate God's chosen people from the face of this earth. Because if he can eradicate God's chosen people, he can eradicate God's covenant and God's word that said, these are my people and they will remain on here as long as I am God. And just 70 years ago, 6 million Jews were killed in the Holocaust. And where were they killed? But none other than in Germany. Germany is the center of the Reformation, of our Christian faith. And yet 70 years later, 80,000 Christian believers visit Israel every year. And in a nation that did not exist in one day now has a population of 8 million Jews. And our rabbi, that joined with us, our guide, both of their grandparents were Holocaust victims. One of them told a story of a miracle. And they said that they had a friend who was a rabbi of 23 synagogues in the city of Haifa. And his grandfather was the only survivor, or his grandmother was the only survivor of the Holocaust in their family. And he said this, he said, if you were to imagine, if you were to tell my grandmother in Auschwitz-Birkenau that 70 years later, her son would be a college graduate with two different graduate degrees, doctorate degrees, that he would be a member of the Congress of the Nation of Israel, and that he would be a rabbi over 23 synagogues in the land of Israel, she would have scoffed at that thought. But yet 70 years later, here is God's land, God's people, being brought back from all corners of the earth. And you and I have a very important part to play. Why? Because we play the part of assistance in building God's kingdom here on earth. We are, our job as the church is to assist God's plan for the ages and for eternity through His nation and His people. See, Paul talks about the Jews in Romans 11th chapter. It's a very, very curious subject. We don't understand. It's veiled to us. It's like seeing things dimly through the fog. We don't know the answers. We don't have the answers. We don't have all the solutions. And Paul says these words. He says, if the Jews stumbled that we should fall, did they stumble that we should fall? Or that they stumbled that they should fall? Certainly not. But no, through the fact that they fell, to provoke them to jealousy, to bring them to a place of recognition, salvation has come to you and to me because of this position. But look what it says in verse number 12. Now if their fall is the riches to the world and their failure the riches for Gentiles, how much more is their fullness? You see, God is bringing them back. God is restoring the nation of Israel. God is going to move in His people, the Jewish people of Israel, and they are going to see, their eyes will be open, and the return of Jesus will come. They play an important, integral role. And in their return, how much of a blessing is there? You see, we cannot shake the coincidence that when the Jewish people started bringing God back to the promised land, revivals started breaking out across the world. We cannot shake the fact that in 1948, the Jewish people became a state, and in the 1950s, revivals started breaking out across America. We cannot shake the fact that as the Jewish people started coming back to the land that God had promised to them, and they started to glorify God once again, that revivals started breaking out in places like China and in the Middle East. We cannot escape the fact that when God is in His home in Israel, the rest of the world benefits. And thus, it is important for us to not find ourselves in a bubble of Western Christianity, to look at Israel as the state on the other side of the world that causes so much drama for everybody else, but rather to recognize that you and I, as believers in Jesus Christ, our role is to assist in seeing and bringing to the Jewish people and to the nation of Israel the revelation of the glorious light of Jesus Christ, that He might return to His people and they might have a place in the end time harvest of God. That is God's plan. And we have a role to play in Israel. And I just want to finish with this. A really cool story. My mom turned me onto a book that I should have read months ago, but after I got bit, I read it. Of a story that we find, I believe today, that is the image of us, the church in America, the Western church, and the people of God. And in 1 Kings, the 5th chapter, there's a story of a man. You might have heard of him before. His name is Solomon. He was the son of the great King David, the giant slayer, the greatest king of Israel, King David. And Solomon had a wonderful task at hand. Solomon had the task of building a permanent temple, a dwelling place, for the presence of God to dwell and exist here on earth. But in this story of Solomon building this temple is another man that was partnered with him that we don't often talk about, that we don't often hear about. This man's name is Hiram, and he was a Gentile king in the country of what we would call today Lebanon. And in 1 Kings in the 5th chapter, there's this amazing story of Solomon as he begins to build God's temple. In verse number 1 of 1 Kings in the 5th chapter, it says that Hiram, the king of Tyre, sent servants to Solomon because he heard they had anointed him king in his place of his father. Listen to this. For Hiram, a Gentile king, always loved David. Here was a Gentile king whose heart was connected to a Jewish king. And as the story goes on, Solomon sent to Hiram saying, "You know my father David could not build a house for the name of the Lord, his God, because of the wars which were fought against him on every side, until the Lord put his foes under the soles of his feet. But now the Lord my God has given me rest on every side. There is neither adversary nor evil occurrence. Behold," Solomon says this, "I purpose to build a house for the name of the Lord my God, as the Lord spoke to my father David, saying, 'Your son, whom I will set on your throne in your place, he shall build the house for my name. Now therefore, command that they cut down cedars for me in Lebanon, your country, and that my servants would be with your servants, and I'll pay you wages for your servants according to whatever you say. For you know there is none among us who has the skill to cut timber like the Sidonians, like your people. Your people are craftsmen, and we want your help.' So it was, when Hiram heard the words of Solomon, he rejoiced greatly and said, 'Blessed be the Lord this day, for he has given David a wise son over this great people.' Then Hiram sent to Solomon saying, 'I've considered the message which you sent me, and I'll do all that you desire concerning cedar and logs, cypress logs. My servants shall bring them down from Lebanon to the sea. I will float them in rafts by the sea to a place that you indicate to me, and I'll have them broken apart there, and you can take them away, and you shall fulfill my desire by giving food to my household.' Then Hiram gave Solomon cedar and cypress logs according to all of Solomon's desire." Verse number 11 talks about what Solomon gave him in reprimand to that. In verse number 12, "And the Lord gave Solomon wisdom, and as he had promised him, there was peace between Hiram and Solomon, and the two of them made a treaty together." And the interesting thing about this story is that here is the Jewish king Solomon, who was tasked to build the house of God. But he built the house of God with the resources and the laborers of a Gentile king whose heart was attached to him. I believe that the story of Hiram and of Solomon is the story of the Western Church of Jesus Christ, us Christians, and our Jewish brothers and sisters on the other side of the world, that our hearts are attached, our hearts are intertwined. Though we may have theological differences and though we may not see things eye to eye, we recognize that we are bound together by the plan of God, and that when we join together in support of God's plan, we are blessed and they are blessed, because God is a blessing to his house. And thus, the responsibility of us, the church today, is to not see this nation afar off on the other side of the world as just something that we should think about and that is something that is special and that God is doing something, but rather to take it on as our own personal responsibility, because Israel needs your support. Israel needs your support. You see, Israel needs your support, and you may not be able to support. You say, "Pastor Luke, what can I do? I can't float cedars from my country across the Atlantic Ocean through the Strait of Gibraltar and all the way to the Mediterranean, to the shores of Israel, to rebuild Tel Aviv and Jerusalem." No, you can't do that. "I don't have money to give. I may not ever make it to Israel, but someday I'll see Jerusalem when Jesus returns." But to see this, to say this, that I can support Israel, at least today, in these two ways. Israel needs your support with your voice. You see, right now, just like from the very day Israel became a nation to even today, Israel is under attack. Every day, rockets are fired into the nation from the countries that are bound to destroy and to wipe them off the face of the earth. And I don't want to get political and I don't want to get all these things, but we have seen, if there's anything that we have seen in the recent history of the United States in the past couple of years, is that the news media on either side of the party lines will sway things to their perspective. And in our day and age, one of the reasons that they brought 30 millennial pastors to Israel is because with young people particularly, Israel is now being projected as the bad guys, as the bullies, as the people are that are camping and squatting on somebody else's land. But did you know that from the very beginning, before the United Nations were ever the United Nations, and they said, Israel will give you this land, even though it was only 9 miles wide, 9 miles wide. They said, we'll never say no to anybody giving us back our land, even if that means that we have to have a two-state solution. But yet, today, there is so much word. There are so many voices bent out to destroy and to diminish Israel. There's a movement called BDS, to boycott, to deinvest and to sanction Israel. Luckily, many states in the United States have already signed agreements in which they would not send government money to companies that support this movement. But Israel needs your voice. Like Chick-fil-A, and the evangelicals and the Christians gathered together for a cause, it's time for us, the Western church, to stand up, even if it's not cool, even if it's socially not acceptable, even if it doesn't make any sense, even if we don't agree with their politics or their ways of doing things, to stand for what God says is important to God and say, I stand with Israel. People aren't going to like you for it. They're going to speak poorly of you for it. They're going to say, stop talking about it. The Jews don't have a place. They don't have a right. They don't have an existence. They don't need to exist today. But you and I, the church, when we stand together, we say no. With my voice, I will stand for what God says is right, and I will back and I will support and I will use what God gave me, my voice, to stand for what God is doing on the other side of this earth. And secondly, how can you and I support Israel? Through our prayers. And not just weak prayers of God bless Israel. The fervent, effectual prayers of a righteous man that God would bring peace to his holy city, Jerusalem. I was there. We had Muslims following us around on the Temple Mount, because if you mention the fact that there was a temple where their Dome of the Rock is today, they will come and dispute it with you, saying that never happened today. There is tension like you could not believe on that side of the world. And they need our prayers. Effective, righteous, fervent prayers for God's people to be delivered, for God's people to be restored, for God's people to be protected, for God's plan to be fulfilled, for their eyes to be opened, for provisions to come, for God's Messiah, Jesus Christ, Yeshua HaMashiach, to return to His holy land on His designated time. They need our support in our voice and in our prayers. As we were ascending to Jerusalem, Psalms 122 through 134 are called the Psalms of the Ascent, in which you read them as you climb the hill up to Jerusalem. Jerusalem is on a high hill. Psalms 126 says, pray for the peace of Jerusalem. And may God bless all those who love her, support her. You see, it is our duty, it is our place to not give a token thought to God's most holy city. See, the Bible tells us in the Old Testament that God's eyes are on Jerusalem 24 hours a day, 365 days a year for eternity. When Jesus returns and the eastern sky splits and we long for that day, guess where the eastern sky splits from? Jerusalem. When Jesus comes back, guess where He comes back to? Jerusalem. When Jesus sets up His reign on earth and we live in peace and harmony with Jesus, guess where we live and we dwell? In Jerusalem. Guess what happens in eternity when God builds? He builds a new Jerusalem in which we live, which means it is our duty as believers in God and in Jesus Christ to support what God is important and to pray for the peace of Jerusalem and Israel. Israel needs our support. And it is our duty as believers. And on the last night, I just want to share this to you, with you. On the last night, as we gathered together and kumbayaed our experience, and everybody talked about how they were deeply touched and impacted, this Orthodox Jewish rabbi who traveled with us, who didn't understand it, we asked him a lot of stupid questions being millennials. As we shared our experiences with him, tears started running down his face. And when it was his turn to speak to these Christian millennials, he told us these words. He said, "In all of my life, I have never been so moved and impacted as I have with these 3 days with you today." And here's what the words of my friend now, Rabbi Penny Dunner of Beverly Hills, said to us. "The future of my future is in your hands." And that is the realization and the reconnection of the Jewish people to the followers of Jesus, is that the future of the future of the Jewish people is in our hands. Israel needs our support. Why should we even do it? Because God told a man back in Genesis in the 12th chapter, a man by the name of Abram, his name was later turned to Abraham. God said this: "I'll bless those who bless you. I'll curse those who curse you. And in you, all the families of the earth shall be blessed." This is the man, the father of Isaac, who was the father of Jacob, whose name was changed to none other than Israel. And God says to those who bless your lineage, Israel, "I will bless you. To those who curse, I will curse you." Church, I believe that time is winding down. I believe that we're closer to the return of Jesus than we've ever been. And now we may not know when he will come back, and there's no scientific formula for that. Jesus himself said nobody knows the hour or the day. It might be in our lifetime. It might not be in our lifetime. But it is the responsibility of the followers of Jesus Christ to be found on the right side of God's plan when he returns. And that is to bless the nation of Israel with our support. And I understand you're not there. I understand you haven't been there. You may never make it there in this lifetime, but you'll see it someday when Jesus returns. But Israel is not just a country on the other side of the world that stirs up drama. It's everything. It's everything. It's where God's eyes are. It's where Jesus Christ will return. It's where he will call us home from. It's everything. And therefore, to you, to me, it's home. And it's our responsibility to support, to be like Haran in this generation, who was a Gentile king. You see, Peter equates you and I. He says, "You are kings. You are priests. You are a holy nation." And our kingdom now, as we join together with our hearts, with our love that navigates the tension and awkwardness of Jewish-Christian relations, to say, we love the same God, and his plan will come to play. Whether we're a part of it or not, I'd rather be a part of it. Amen. I will bless those who bless you. I will curse those who curse you. Church, I'd ask you to do this. I'd ask you to go home tonight, somehow on your calendar, sometime in your devotion, sometime in your prayer, to go before God and to lift up his holy nation, to lift up his people. Currently, right now, there are 22 Arabic nations that surround Israel that seek to destroy them from the face of the earth. Don't care what the media says. Israel sends irrigation pipelines to the Gaza Strip to help them with crops and farming. And do you know that the rockets fired back into Israel are made out of Israeli irrigation pipelines? They don't tell us this in the news. It is our responsibility as Christians to support God's people. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for your word. I know it's a challenge to us. God, as I was there, you just rent my heart. And I pray that, Lord, as we seek after you, we seek after your will, we seek after your desire, Lord, I pray that you would rent our hearts, open our hearts to the love of your people, Lord, that we would not see them as little, or we would see them as a bygone era, but God, that we would see them as your chosen people, Father, with a divine plan for the redemption of the world. And God, we thank you that we are so blessed to be a part of it, that you have chosen to graft us, to take us from something that was wild to something that was cultivated by you, Lord. And I thank you that you have partnered with us in this day and age, God, that through our very eyes, we are seeing things that have never been seen before on this earth. Lord, that your return, the return of Jesus, is closer than ever before. And God, I pray today that your hand would be on the nation of Israel. I pray today that your hand would be upon our Jewish brothers and sisters. Lord, I pray for your protection and your divine guidance with our messianic believers and Jewish brothers and sisters in the nation of Israel, that they would be a shining light of the glory of Jesus Christ, that your plan would be fulfilled. Lord, that you would come, Maranatha, return, O God, and bring peace to this world through your nation, Israel. Bless them in Jesus' mighty name. We all together said, amen. 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 Kind of a weird night, kind of a weird message, I know. But I tell you what, I say this, and I say this out loud, and I say this with all of my heart. It is my personal vendetta, especially with us young people, to pop the bubble of Western Christianity that we live in, that our eyes might be open to what God is doing on the other side of the world, outside of the borders of this nation, that we might see that we are only a small part of God's bigger picture, and that we must support what God is doing. And I'll tell you what, when God is in his home, the whole world benefits. And just remember that the Jewish people think about you, that the future of their future is in your hands. It is our responsibility to support and to be a part of. Thanks for being a part of it tonight. Thanks for bearing with me. As I bear my heart to you, God ripped me up in many ways, and there are things that I'd love to share with you, and I'm sure they'll come out in the years to come of what God has done in my life through this trip. But I know this, that God's desire for us is to be a part of his people. The amazing thing is that God included us into his covenant. You see, we were outsiders looking in. We were window shoppers. We could look through the glass and see God's redemptive plan and God's promises, but they weren't for us. They didn't last for us. They didn't mean anything to us. They were for God's chosen people. But through Jesus Christ, God's plan came to you and I, in the sense that the door was opened through the death of Jesus on that cross, that we might be brothers and sisters with those whose God's plan was for, that we might be adopted into God's covenant plan through Jesus Christ, that we might share in eternal glory, and that we might find a position in heaven, in eternity with God and his son Jesus through his redemptive plan on that cross. But that doesn't come because you and I sit in a church. That doesn't come because we support Israel. That doesn't come because we have a religious pretense or a mindset. That comes because you and I have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. You see, God's not after religion. I believe that there's a movement within the world today that the foundations of religion are being shaken, and we realize and recognize that God is not after our penance. God is not after our attendance. God is not after our repetitive confessions. God is after our hearts. And today, I want you to do something for me in the next 4 minutes. I want you to look into your heart. I want you to look into your life, and I want you to ask yourself this question. Where am I with God? Where do I stand in my relationship with God? You can ask it like this. If I was to leave today and I was to die, would I go to heaven or would I go to hell? Where do you stand with God? You see, so often we think that everything's good between us and God because we think it's all right. Because we hope so, because we want to, because we desire. So often we think that everything's good between us and God because we go to church, because we have a cross around our neck, because we've said a prayer, because we were baptized or christened, or because we went to Sunday school or catechism classes. So often we think that we're good with God because we do good things, we do good deeds, we don't cheat on our taxes, and we give to charitable organizations like Red Cross or UNICEF. But you see, God's not after those things. God's not after your religion. He didn't send Jesus Christ to die on a cross that you might be affiliated with one brand of religion or another. You see, God sent his only begotten Son. Jesus says these words. He says that he is the way, the truth, and the life. And he says no one goes to the Father except through him. See, the only way that you and I can find ourselves in a position with God, in a position that we are no longer on the outside looking in, that the promises of God that we read in the Bible are no longer just for them, but for also for us, is through his Son, Jesus Christ. And Jesus says these words in John, the third chapter, speaking to a religious leader, Nicodemus, a Pharisee, a student of the Bible, of the Word of God. Jesus says these words, Nicodemus, in order to inherit the kingdom of God, an inheritance is destined for somebody who is on the inside. In order to inherit the kingdom of God, you must be born again. That's a weird term. It's a phrase that we don't hear often. And if we do, you've probably heard it in light of media and society and movies and weirdo, crazy, out of control Christianity, those people that are kind of half nuts. But let me tell you something. From the beginning of God's word to the end of God's word, it's always meant the same thing, and the same thing in the heart and the eyes of God. It means that you've given all of your heart, you've given all of your life to God the Father through his Son, Jesus Christ. It's an all or nothing relationship. Today I want to offer you the invitation to receive eternal life and abundant life here on earth through the fulfillment of a relationship with Jesus Christ. You see, God's not a manipulator. He's not a conniver. He's not going to force his way in. He's not going to kick down the door of your heart. Well, if God wants me, he'll take me. God wanted you so much, he sent his only begotten Son to die on a cross naked for you and I, so that in turn, we could have a personal relationship with him. Think about it like this. The creator of the universe, who holds the world in his hands, wants to know you intimately, and more so, he wants you to know him, his heart, his desire, his plan for your life. And that only comes through a relationship with Jesus Christ. Jesus says in the book of Revelation to people in the church, he says, listen, I'll return, and when I come back, I'd rather find that you're hot, I'd rather find that you're cold, he says, because if I find that you're lukewarm, he says, I'll vomit you from my mouth. It's a shocking statement out of the words of Jesus. Shortly after that, he says these words. He says, but behold, I stand at the door and I knock. He says, if you just open your heart, he says, I'll come. I'll be with you. You'll be with me. We'll have communion, relationship together. Today, I want to offer you the invitation of eternal life and salvation through Jesus Christ. You've been living your life your way, doing your own thing long enough. There's an emptiness on the inside of you that you can't seem to fill. You can't fill it with friends and relationships and titles and money and possessions, because it's an emptiness that's designed to be filled by God himself through Jesus Christ. And today, I believe that there are those of you in this place that the Holy Spirit is knocking on your heart saying, will you accept the invitation of salvation and eternal life today? And I want to give you that opportunity. So here's what I'm going to ask. Would you do this in the last moments, the closing moments of tonight? Would you do this? Would you take a moment of intimacy and shut everything else out around you? Shut out what goes on tomorrow and what you're going to eat for dinner or whatever it might be. And would you do this? Would you close your eyes? Would you bow your head for just a few moments? And I want you to look at your life. Where do you stand with God? Quiet your mind and listen to the invitation of God. Is the Holy Spirit knocking on your heart saying, it's time for you to have a relationship with me? It's time for you to choose life through my Son. Is it time for you to respond? Is it time for you to stop doing life your way and to start doing it God's way? If that's you today, just a moment, I want to give you the opportunity. Here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to count to three. I'll go one, two, and on the count of three, I'll go bang. I'll smack my hands together real loud just like that, and I'll ask you to do something. I'm going to ask you to pop your hands up. You see, what you're doing by the raising of your hand, you're saying, Pastor Luke, today I want to give my heart, I want to give my life to Jesus. And in doing so, I'll see your hand, I'll acknowledge it. What we're going to do right after that is we're going to pray a prayer of salvation together to change your destiny, to be a part of the family of God for eternity, and to accept and invite Jesus into your heart, into your life, to see a change in your life beginning today. Everything will change. But it starts by making that decision. If you've never given your heart, you've never given your life to Jesus, if that's you, just a moment, you pop your hand up. If you're not sure, you say, man, I wonder if I should. You should. Listen, God does not want you walking about life hoping that you might make it. God says, I sent my Holy Spirit to be in the inside of you as my seal of approval in you. If you're not sure tonight, make sure. If you've been living lukewarm, doing your own thing instead of God's thing, if that's you tonight, you pop your hand up. I'll see it. I'll acknowledge it. And what you're saying is, Pastor Luke, I want to be included in that prayer of salvation today. I'll see your hand. I'll acknowledge it. You can put it right back down. And right after that, I want to shake your hand and we're going to pray a prayer together and change destinies. All across this auditorium, from the front to the back, from the side to the side, wherever you're at, if you're watching on closed circuit television around the campus or at home on the live stream, wherever you're at, if that's you this moment, the Spirit of God speaking to you right where you're at, I'm going to count to three. And if that's you, you pop your hand up. I'll see it. I'll acknowledge it. Put it right back down. And we'll pray that prayer together wherever you're at. This is the moment, the time, the day of your salvation is today. When you go from being the outsider to now being the insider in God. Will you respond to the invitation of Jesus Christ? Today is the day of your salvation. You ready? I'm going to count to three. If that's you, you pop your hand up. I'll see it. I'll acknowledge it and put it right back down. You ready? Here we go. One, two, three. Let me see your hands in this place today. I see you. I see you. I see you right there. I see that hand. I see that hand. I see that hand back there. If that's you in this place today, you pop your hand up. If that's you, I want to give my heart. I want to give my life to Jesus. Anybody else in this place today? About eight wise people. Anybody else in this place today? If that's you, you pop your hand up so I can see it. Anybody else today? About eight wise people. Spirit of God speaking to you saying, was that you? Would you respond today? Anybody else today? Well, let's give the Lord a great big praise. Let's give the Lord a great big praise. Hey, listen, I said I wanted to shake your hand. I want to pray with you. For all of those of you that raised your hand, I'm so proud of you guys. You popped your hands up. I mean, your hands skyrocketed into the sky, and that says, I want to do something with my life. And now, you said, I want to make a decision for Jesus. Let's pray a prayer together. I want to shake your hand. I want to look you in the eye. I want to congratulate you, and I want to share in this moment together with you. And so here's what I'm asking you to do. We're all going to stand up, and as we stand up, my friend here, Elijah, is going to sing a song. As he does, I want you to grab your coat, your sweater, your purse, your Bible, a friend, if you need a friend, a family member, if you want to bring a family member, get out of into the aisles, come meet me right here. Let me shake your hand, and let's pray a prayer of salvation together. That's you. Come and meet me right here. Let's change destinies together right now. Right on, brother. Hang out right here, okay? If that's you, you come. Can I get a high five? Yes. If you raised your hand, or you should have, come on, this is your moment. This is your time. Oh, come on, I'll get you, girl. Congratulations. Give me a high five, big man. Give me a big one. Give me a big one. Oh, good one. Give me a good one, real solid. Yeah, congratulations. Hey, guys, listen. Today is the first day of the rest of your life. I'm going to lead you in a prayer, but I want you to understand some things, okay? God doesn't listen to the words of your mouth like you repeat an abracadabra magical prayer and everything is good. He listens to the prayers of your heart. So I'm going to lead you in a prayer, and I'm going to give you the words to say, but don't let them be my words. You make them your words. You make them your heart. God sees that. He recognizes it. He says, if you confess with your mouth and you believe in your heart that Jesus Christ is Lord and raised from the dead, you'll be saved. So that's what we're going to do today. So I'm going to ask you to join with me in prayer. I'll say the words you say them right after me. As a matter of fact, we're all going to say it together, all right? You at home, you can say this prayer with me right now if you want to on the live stream as well. Let's all bow our heads one more time. Everybody join in with me, but especially you guys up here in front. And let's go before the Lord and let's pray this together. Would you join with me today? Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you today and I acknowledge that I need you today. I make the commitment to leave my past behind. I ask that you forgive me of my sins, cleanse me of all the things I've done, and give me a new future in Jesus Christ. Today, I profess and I proclaim that I believe in Jesus. I receive him as my Lord and as my Savior and as the leader of my life. Fill me today with your Holy Spirit. Today, from this day forward, I commit my life to you. I commit my heart to you. I'm headed for heaven, denying my presence in hell. Today, I am a Christian. I'm saved in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Praise God. Hey guys, really quickly, see this guy right over here waving at you in this really cool biker jacket? His name is Pastor Joel. Pastor Joel's gotta be one of the coolest guys we have here at the church. He wants to do just a couple things with you. He wants to take you guys right over there. He wants to give you some free information. We got some things to help point you in the right direction on this journey that you're going on, all right? It's a journey. You didn't arrive today, you started today, all right? We're gonna point you in the right direction. And for you guys, we even got comic books for you, okay? That your mom and dad can help you read them with, and you can have a good time together. He's gonna pray with you if you need some prayer, and he's gonna point you in the right direction, invite you to come back and get connected with somebody that will help build you up in the ways of God right here at the church. So if you just turn to your left, my right, go right over there with my friend, Pastor Joel. Congratulations, guys.